Today is October 29th, 2024. I'm Todd Agassi-Ork with my friend Jared Kuroiwa. We are sitting in a restaurant, so we'll see how good Adobe Podcasts enhanced us with getting rid of some of the ambient sound. Although I kind of like the ambient sound.
Yeah, we get that.
So I'm recording this using a conference microphone sitting at a table in front of us, so we'll try not to adapt the table. And recording it to an iPhone 15 Pro Max, so 1 year old phone. Just got its AR. It just became smart. So Jared and I just recorded a brief video showing some of the AR VR glasses. Yours were AR glasses.
It's more AR, yeah.
Me, more AR glasses. There was an Xreal, and what was the first one?
A Brilliant Labs Frame.
Brilliant Labs Frame. Okay, that's a long name. They should have thought that.
Singapore based.
I'll attach a video with this audio podcast, and we'll see what you can do with it. So, first thing I wanted to ask you something we didn't look at. I don't think you looked at it in person. The new Ray-Ban something 2, I think, or whatever it's called.
The new Ray-Ban one? I haven't looked at that one.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And then there's the Meta, then the Quest 2S?
3S.
3S?
Yeah.
And I know you haven't bought it, but have you guys just kind of...
I didn't bother. There's a reason why I haven't bought it.
Okay, I want to know that.
Yeah.
Yeah, why didn't you? Because it's not AR?
No, so I had a Quest 2.
Okay.
And it was just too heavy, too bulky, too hot. And I had bought the entire headgear to balance out the right system in your head.
Right.
And so I just gave it to one of my nephews. And I'm sure he's enjoying it because it's pretty awesome. But it wasn't for me. And so... The 3 came out, the Pro and the 3 came out. The 3 had what are called pancake lenses. It's layers of lens for the projector that's not using a Fresnel.
It's all
like a lighthouse.
Right.
And so it has much a wider field of view. It has a very much smaller, I forgot exactly the term for it, but the spread between each pixel. And so you don't get that Barnberry effect where you see lines.
Okay, got it.
And so that's why 3 was pretty awesome. And that's also why 3 was so expensive. But it was like a 2K-ish resolution. So when the 3S came out, what Meta's doing is they're trying to figure out the pricing in the market. And the Pro did not sell very well. And I think that was at $1,000 or so. And so the 3S takes the same lenses out of the 2, but the electronics out of the 3. And so... I didn't like the 2 because of the lenses, and so I'm not going to like the 3S because of the lenses.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I didn't get the 3 because I had pre-ordered a device from Immerse called the Visor. They just did a demo maybe a month ago, and it was terrible.
Oh.
Like, nothing worked.
Oh.
And so I've been following them. I still left my pre-order in because it's $1,000.
Well,
but it includes a lifetime membership. That's why I decided to be up front. And the reason is because the company Immerse is the same company that I was using with the Quest 2 that gives you those virtual monitors in space. And so what Immerse was doing is using the Apple Vision Pro technology, but using their software to drive it. And so they end up with a device that weighs about the same as a cell phone. And much thinner than the Apple Vision Pro.
Yeah.
But with 4K pancake lenses, so even better than the 3, and a better pass-through camera.
You know, so for those of us who grew up with sub-VGA resolution, for you, does it make a huge difference between 2 to 4K? I don't know if I can see the difference. I found that from there.
But I think you'll notice it when you're in the VR space. Because if you have multiple monitors, those multiple monitors are not all 4K.
Got it.
Because it's the 4K total resolution, right? And so the more monitors you put, say you put 3, that's 1/3. So now you have, 1080s or whatever, or 1280s.
You have, like, super, super VGA.
Right.
Which is still good.
Yeah. But then, just watch old YouTube videos, because I do sometimes, and... You see what SD TV looked like, the 640 TV, and it looks like crap.
Well,
and so, yeah, I think you don't notice 4K as much unless you're seeing motion or you're reading text.
Yeah. But that creates a frame rate that will also make a difference, right?
And so most of the new glasses that we've seen now are coming out at 90. Some of them can ramp up to 120. But I found that when you wrap it up to 120, it does get hot. The temperature does make a difference. I mean, it does, it's noticeable. But I think Apple Vision Pro is probably in the 90-120 range as well.
Well, but Apple is
$3,500 is pretty much the no. Yeah, not only that, but it's super heavy.
And I will say, for, I mean, I know nothing about thermal dynamics and all that, but somehow Apple does heat remediation better than everybody else.
Yeah.
Like my iPad, generally speaking, doesn't get hot.
Yeah.
Whereas my Android tablet, it gets hot.
Yeah. But that magnesium alloy framing that they use and how they do their heat sinks.
Yeah.
Which is why, for the most part, Apple devices are rarely repairable. It's true. Because they really do pack stuff in there, but there's a reason why it's packed that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know my early theory about the early iPads, about why they were so full? Apple has found a way to punt heat into another dead cold dimension. And that's not it.
But no, Apple does an amazing job of keeping heat away.
Although I look at a thermal warning on my iPhone. I think I had an iPhone 4 or 6 or something, and I was sitting outdoors, but in the shade, at like my daughter's track meet, and I was just checking something on the phone, and I got a thermal warning on it. Very unusual. By the way, I think I've told you this story before, but so we're recording on an iPhone 15 because on my Pixel 7a, which I have originally used for these in-person podcasts, because my early lavalier mics did not work with my phone for whatever reason. Henry, I got thermal warning sitting in the shade outdoors at a breezy, not too hot day, like 7-8 degrees. Paul Lawler and I were like having lunch and doing a podcast like this. I'm looking at my phone and say, Paul, I'm going to shut down the podcast because I'm getting a football.
My iPad mini every once in a while will give me a thermal.
Really?
If I'm playing for it too loud.
Right. Which
means the one before the new one.
Oh, 6.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I just got my 7, or actually, technically it's an iPad mini 7. iPad mini 17A Pro.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah.
But I call it iPad mini 7. I want to ask you a question. So you've got iPad mini 6. I have never seen the jelly roll. When you're scrolling, do you see? I don't understand what the problem is.
It only shows in, I think it's landscape mode, but in portrait mode.
Okay.
And it's the left and right side shifting at different speeds.
Right.
But I've never used my iPad in portrait mode. I always have it in landscape mode, and so I never see it.
Okay. And you probably don't do scroll fast enough like you do.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that was one of the things I was concerned about even when I first picked it up. And then when I played with it, I couldn't
find it. Yeah.
Okay. But going back to your glasses, so the Xreal is the set or pair that you're using for your daily work now, right?
Yeah.
You don't use an external monitor.
No.
That is your external monitor.
Yeah.
Amazing. And what's the res on that?
It's 14? I think it's 1600 by 1200 or something like that. So it's not great, but it's not bad either.
It's like a high-res big screen.
Yeah.
And use single virtual
one? I just use one. Yeah.
I don't see why you would need more than one, actually. But
right. I mean,
when it's that big, virtually.
Yeah. And because, like you saw, it's like looking with blinders. If I put two monitors and then wide and big, I have to turn my head anyway.
Yeah.
Sad.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty cool.
I enjoy that. All right. Well, let's just see how this goes. I'm going to... this will be a short podcast. Unless you have anything else you can claim with.
Well, and the thing about pre-ordering things is a lot of these companies don't make it. And so I pre-ordered this Rocket device, which is basically just a computer, but it's using the Snapdragon XR2. And they haven't been able to get their DRM license, and so that doesn't exist yet.
Well, it's like Qualcomm itself couldn't ship its...
Right. That was the other thing I bought, was the dev kit.
Yeah.
And that was weird because they sent out some of them to the famous people.
Right.
And so the people that ordered early, like me, that wasn't famous, didn't get one. And then they canceled it, but they let them keep it. So I'm kind of a little jealous on that. But at the same time, it sounded like it didn't quite work. There were some issues with it, like they had to remove the HDMI, stuff like that.
I think you got to use a USB-C out to get a HDMI.
But then I use HDMI, I use USB-C.
Normally, right?
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I know you're not I don't think you're a Mac fan.
I'm not a fan of anything, but yeah.
But I'm really tempted by the new Mac Mini.
Yeah.
The M4-based Mac Mini.
I have to admit, the Mac Mini looks interesting. There's a couple of mini formats that I've been looking at. I do have a little Asus mini computer that I run Olama on and
Ubuntu.
So it kind of like sits as its own little web server internally. So I can test out the AI models without having things on the internet. And that format's just perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really nice.
Low power.
Yeah.
Yeah. The only thing was, I think maybe because the M4 draws so much, well, it's not true. This iPad Pro is M4. It does not use USB-C for power. I noticed he has a proprietary plug on it when I was looking at the photos this morning.
Uh-huh.
And so I don't know if you can just plug power into one of the USB-C ports and then power it that way. Because I have a AMD Intel, I forget. I mean, AMD or Intel powered, you know, NUC,
uh-huh.
Little tiny PC. And it has a barrel roll plug, but I just showed a USB-C, you know, with like 60 watts and it's fine.
Yeah, the thing is that to get higher performance, it usually increases the power draw.
Yeah.
And so that's what they were even saying about the dev kit was that when they cranked up the performance on it,
yeah.
They noticed the power draw was huge. Like it kicked up to like a normal device, not a laptop.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's like kind of the balance that you need. And I'm assuming the Mac is going to want to push more towards the performance end.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's probably why they have a proprietary.
It's got a lot of cores to push. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's, I was hoping it'd come in at $499, but $599 is not bad.
Yeah.
And it does have 16 gigs of RAM to start.
Yeah.
So I guess it's a minimum.
Yeah.
For their Apple Intelligence stuff on it.
Nowadays, I think 16 is kind of the minimum. That 32 is desired. Everything is all at $1,500 when you want it equipped the way you want it.
Hey, how did I get on my Surface Pro? I forget what I have. Like, that might have 16. Yeah, no, in fact, Copilot plus PC, 16 gigs is all shit a minimum.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's what I thought.
I've been playing with the Copilot enough.
There's nothing to play with, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I mean? I bought it because I was, despite the privacy concerns, I was curious about recall.
Yeah.
And then the image stuff I was kind of curious about too, but as it turns out, I just use it as a fast laptop right now. And unfortunately, it doesn't do the one fast thing I wanted to do, which is run my 360 video editor. It's a 360 editor. Well, not
installed. They didn't ARM convert software.
This is the weird thing. So it's got an Intel and ARM installed version.
Uh-huh.
Download the ARM version. It says, no, you need an ARM computer. Then,
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's what I just got. But so that's the one thing I wanted to use on it is, I also had some initial printer driver problems for months and months. I couldn't print from it. Now it works fine. But the physically attached magnetic keyboard from Microsoft is terrible. It only works like 30% of the time when it's already connected. I got to pop it off and put it back on. So I got it for review. I got like a $60 or $70 magnetically attached with Bluetooth keyboard. But it still attaches, so it's like a regular laptop.
I know,
like it looks great.
Huh?
It sees it 100% of the time.
So is it actually passing data through the magnet?
No, that's just the connectivity.
It's just connected. Yeah.
It's a convenience, so you could put in your briefcase or whatever.
And the Microsoft one doesn't have that. It's not Bluetooth.
No, you have to pay like $400 for the Bluetooth keyboard, and I did not feel like paying for a new Bluetooth keyboard.
Right.
Anyhow, I'm pretty happy with that.
Yeah.
I also didn't pay $400 for the iPad Pro Magic Keyboard. What a quick call.
Yeah.
Because I thought that was astronomically too expensive for me. But you know what? The sub $100 or just barely over $100 keyboards, they're pretty darn good.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're pretty good.
I've been using the Logitech Keys to Go.
Yeah.
It is so small. It's kind of funny, but it types fine.
Yeah.
So I kind of like it. Yeah.
Yeah. The old Logitech K380,
I have a 380.
That is a great keyboard.
Yeah. I didn't keep the problem though is that because it's AAA batteries,
yes.
It's a little bit bigger form factor.
Yes.
And so that's why I went with the Keys to Go just to get it a little smaller, just to see. And it's tiny.
But that uses alkaline batteries too, right?
But it's using the coin
battery. Oh, that's right.
Yes.
The 2032s.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just got the newish Logitech Pop Icon.
Yeah.
Keyboard combo. Which is its main claim to fame is it's already made recycled material, and that it's supposed to recycle itself pretty
environmentally friendly way.
Okay.
And the keyboard uses, keyboard uses a pair of AAA alkalines.
Okay.
And the mouse uses a single AA alkaline.
Double A.
Huh. And it's supposed to last for months. I don't like the typing as much as I do on the 380, but it's not bad. I gave it a pretty good review.
Okay.
And I think it uses alkaline batteries for recycling. So you recycle the keyboard. You don't have this lithium ion
death trap.
Yeah. Something to throw away, you know? So I get it. You know, I understand that.
I've been using Logitech's, I think it's, they call it the Pebble Mouse. Is that what it's called? The little flat one?
Yeah, I see that.
It's really tiny. Again, I've been trying to minimize the amount of space that I take up at my desk. So glasses, laptop, and this keyboard and mouse, that's it. So I can move anywhere.
I got a finger mouse recently.
Do you like it?
Well, I'm pausing because I like the concept. It needs more miniaturization.
Uh-huh.
But the concept was brilliant.
I have one that has a trackpad on the top of it, so it has a big signet ring. I don't like it. I did pre-order a Mutra band, or Mutra link, I think they call them. So that company, Mutra, I think it's Mutra, M-U-D-R-A.
Yeah.
It does that neural link type of movement that Meta did on their glasses.
Right.
So it's supposed to detect your... the actual nerve firings or something for your hand control, so it's supposed to be better. And so this company, Mutra, had come out with one for Apple devices only.
Yeah.
But now they came out with one that's just general use, so it'll work with anything. And I think it's supposed to ship in January. So I'm really looking forward to that. Because I have been looking for some type of spatial mouse type of thing.
Yeah.
Because, like you saw, using your phone as a pointer for the extra is a pain in the butt.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
You must be used to it by now, though, right?
But it's still not that good.
Still not natural.
Yeah. And that's what the Apple Vision Pro brought to the game that's better than anything.
Yeah.
And that hopefully Immerse will have is it has eye tracking on top of the hand tracking.
That's true.
And so those is what you're looking at before you click, so it gets a better position. But with these neural band things like what Meta use, supposedly they're really awesome as far as the precision. So we'll see.
Yeah, something that goes on your hand or wrist that lets kind of natural pointing, like magic incantation.
Exactly. And supposedly it detects the movement as well as you clicking your fingers together.
Yeah.
Which fingers, rotating your wrist, stuff like that. And so you're exactly right that if it actually does work, it'd be amazing.
It'd be like Harry Potter.
Oh yeah. And it'd be perfect. I wanted a keyboard like that, but I heard the Apple Vision Pro and it isn't that good. And I think it's because people expect to be pushing buttons.
Lack of tactile feedback is a problem.
Right. And so I think that's what the problem is with those types of devices being used as that. But then when you talk about AI and doing voice transcription, if I could talk to it, just as good to me.
I think more about that, you know?
Really?
Yeah, I think because my speech is not that fluent. I mean, by that, I mean, I think I speak English okay-ish, but I pause and I.
And then you use the hand and feed it.
Right? I mean,
to send out a memo or an email?
In theory. So,
I mean, I think, you know, I'm looking forward to that.
You know, in fact, not the response, but I before we started the podcast, I mentioned to you that I had kind of a complaint about a recent... call outage incident we had in my area, and I sent to a government official, and I got a response I sent it last night, so less than 12 hours.
Huh.
And this is that doesn't make sense. You know, these folks usually don't respond that quickly. I'm pretty sure they're using Copilot Pro to respond, because it picked out some keywords from my email, and it said, you know, it's very,
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Electric outage.
And he played a pretty good. I thought it did a very good job. If you had to ask me if it was a human or an AI, I would go, I don't know.
Yeah.
Could go either way.
I tell you that the Lipwick LM podcast is just amazing how natural sounding the people are.
Yes.
I'll come to say that to him. The jokes and it's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My daughter says that the current AI is a little too flirty.
And that was the problem with that last release, I think, with from OpenAI, that people thought that it's like
do people really want others to be speaking that way?
Yeah. Like, where actually do you actually know speak like that? You probably not.
Yeah.
But yeah, definitely, it's definitely interesting. We have my wife's company, I think, is going to roll out Copilot Pro to all their employees.
Really?
Yeah.
That's like $60 or something, right?
$30 a month per seat.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they've been taking little lessons about that.
Yeah.
And, you know, AI basics and Gen AI, learn what Gen AI and LLMs are. It's pretty interesting.
I set up a test where I agree with three people, and I haven't heard positive things because they couldn't find the use case that they would really use it on a regular basis.
Well, it could be.
So, but it's because I think we use a combination of different platforms. So like we're using Anthropic and we're using OpenAI. So I think people have latched on to different things that they like on certain products rather than having one that could be encompassing that we pay for.
What do you think of Anthropic? That's Claude, right?
Yeah.
Claude AI. What do you think of that? Do you like it?
Yeah. It's really good. I tend to lean towards the OpenAI side or using Mistral or one of the open source AIs.
Yeah. When my daughter was doing an internship with a media company in London, I had not actually heard of Anthropic's Claude AI until there, but she said, hey, we're using this thing called Claude AI. And she tried it. I go, no, I don't even know what that is. This is last year, I think. So
I think our creative guys like it. I think they like the way it writes.
Could be. And listen, again, this was a media company. You know, did it. In the old days, they did like magazines and stuff.
Yeah. I think the fear is that if you use some of the other AIs, it sounds, you could tell that it's AI. That's the thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't quite pass the modern Turing test.
Yeah.
But these new small models that run on phones, like the new Apple one, the Gemini.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to see how those come out, because then you're going to start seeing that type of functionality in all devices.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really fantastic. I mean, you know, for those of us who couldn't find enough compute power to run, you know, like, what was I doing? 16 neurons?
A Drosophilip?
You're like, oh, darn, if I could only do more than 16, if I could only do 16 neurons then, it would be so much nicer. it's a whole different world.
Yeah. I'm still waiting for more of this to get integrated to more business tools. Like, I don't understand why Google hasn't integrated something like this into Google Analytics. I mean, I know that
interesting.
It already kicks out some type of predictive kind of stuff, but it'd be nice to see more of those tools wrapped into that data set. But maybe they're just working on it, or they're just adding pieces to it.
Or it might be in a different tool that they...
Right.
They have so many.
Where they're selling it to you.
Yeah. They have like Looker and, you know, this, that, and other thing.
So Looker's pretty good.
Yeah.
And I think they've integrated AI into some of the Looker functions. I use it more as a report generator, so it's kind of like the new Crystal reports.
Oh my God. To talk about old guys.
I'm talking about Crystal reports in decades.
Oh, boy. It's like we were talking about Foxburn.
Yeah, exactly.
Which I think he said it.
In
15 years, I think.
My career was based upon Foxborough.
I did a lot of stuff using that. To talk to mainframe, actually, so I hear you. I hear you. All righty, let's see. Well, it's about 1 o'clock, so I'm going to thank my friend Jared. We had a great lunch. We'll see how... I do the podcast, and Asha did a good job at cleaning this up.
Yeah.
And fun discussion, and I'll also post in a video which is supplementary to this. Talk to you later.